From prominent water towers where it's said the spirits of heroes long past still roam after dark, to historic house museums whose grounds play host to apparitions resulting from vicious murders. Are you ready for the most haunted places in Chicago? Number 5. The John J. Glessner House. The John J. Glessner House, located off South Prairie Avenue in Chicago, Illinois, is an architecturally significant 19th century residence designed by notable architect Henry Hobson Richardson, and that's operated as the popular haunt, the Glessner House. The home was originally designed from 1885 to 1886 and was completed a year later in 1887 for one John Jacob Glessner. The Glessner House was one of Henry Hobson Richardson's last works, as he died in 1886, before construction was even completed. After John died in 1936, the home was given to the American Institute of Architects, who returned it to the Glessner family when they could no longer manage upkeep. In 1937, the family deeded the home to the Armour Institute, which was the precursor to the present-day Illinois Institute of Technology. In 1945, the Institute leased the house to the Lithographic Technical Foundation, who installed large printing presses in many of its rooms. When the foundation finally migrated to Pittsburgh through the early 1960s, the house's integrity was threatened with demolition. In 1966, the Chicago Architecture Foundation was founded in an effort to save the Glessner House. The foundation purchased the grounds, and within a few years, the Glessner descendants returned original furniture. The John J. Glessner House was opened to the public for tours in 1971, with the museum opening later as a nonprofit in 1994 while also acting to administrate the property. In present times, many of the house's rooms have been accurately restored to their original appearance. The property is thought to be haunted by members of the Glessner family, who resided at the house for nearly 50 years, and a number of apparitions matching family members' descriptions, as well as the descriptions of workmen and women associated, have been sighted, clad in clothing spanning the ages. All across the property, many report extreme cold spots, doors opening and closing on their own, and disembodied footsteps. Electronic malfunctions and unnatural battery death are common across the premises, accompanied by lights turning on and off by themselves, orbs in the backgrounds of photographs, and objects sighted moving spatially when no one else is around. Lastly, the spirit of Henry Hobson Richardson has been sighted in the bedroom area as well as on the stairway, seemingly inspecting his impressive work. Interestingly enough, initial reports of encounters with Henry's ghost actually date back to the Glessner family itself. Number 4. The Chicago Water Tower. The Chicago Water Tower, located off North Michigan Avenue in Chicago, Illinois, is a contributing property and landmark site that boasts the title of being the second oldest water tower in the United States, and today acts as part of the Magnificent Mile, a prominent shopping district within the city. The tower was originally constructed between 1867 and 1869 to house a large local water pump meant to siphon water from Lake Michigan. In addition to its implementation in firefighting, it also helped regulate water surges throughout the whole of the region. The tower gained attention following the Great Chicago Fire of 1871, during which, from October 8th to October 10th, a good portion of the city would burn, resulting in around 3.3 square miles of destruction, leaving more than 100,000 residents homeless and killing 300. The Chicago Water Tower was one of the few structures that survived the blaze, and one of the only that remains standing today. The tower underwent its first renovation from 1913 to 1916, when many of its limestone bricks were replaced. In 1969, the tower was renamed as the American Landmark Water, and in 1978, it underwent its second major renovation, which mostly aimed at interior alterations. The Chicago Water Tower now serves as a Chicago Office of Tourism art gallery, known as the City Gallery, and features the work of a number of local artists, filmmakers, and photographers. Legend tells that, during the Great Chicago Fire, as everyone fled, one brave firefighter stayed behind in the tower to make sure the pumps continued to function. As the blaze raged on, closing in around him, he chose to hang himself rather than burn to death. His apparition has been sighted rushing around the building, covered in ash, a determined look on his face. Reported around the tower are shadowy figures seen darting about, faces that randomly appear in reflections, and instances in which police have been called to the premises for noise complaints or suspicious activity regarding potential intruders, only to discover the tower completely vacant. On two separate occasions, once in 1875 and again in 1881, desperate men have ended their lives by way of jumping from the tower. In present times, many have reported sighting bodies plummeting from the top, only to disappear a second before impact. Lastly, reported all across the property are orbs caught in the backgrounds of photographs, the smell of smoke with no origin, instances of lights turning on and off throughout the building when it's locked at night, and the constant feeling of being watched or followed by someone unseen. Number 3, Death Alley. Death Alley, or officially Couch Place, is a notable alley running behind the James M. Nederlander Theater in Chicago, Illinois, that gained its nicknames, another being the Alley of Death, after it was transformed into a temporary morgue following the Iroquois Theater fire in 1903. The first theater to sit on the alleyway was the Iroquois, which opened its doors on November 23rd of 1903, offering up an impressive capacity of 1,602, stretched between three audience levels. In a spot of poor planning, the theater featured only one staircase to serve the first and second balconies, and only one entrance and exit. On Wednesday, December 30th of the same year, a matinee performance of Drury Lane musical Mr. Bluebeard sold out, with the theater foolishly offering standing room to hundreds more. It's estimated that the property had around 2,200 patrons packed within, a number of whom were children, when, during the performance, sparks from an arc light ignited a theater curtain. The fire quickly grew out of control. Chillingly, all of the fire escapes were locked, and only three could be forced open. Unfortunately, as doors were opened, the fire was fueled by backdraft even further, forcing many to jump from unfinished or frozen fire escapes into the alley below. A number of theatergoers died of asphyxiation or even being crushed under the stampeding mob. It's estimated that, when all was said and done, 602 died on the day of the fire, with even more dying throughout the following weeks from their injuries. The bodies of the dead, 212 of which were children, were laid to rest in the alley behind the theater. In 1904, the theater was reopened as the Colonial, remaining active until its demolition in 1925. The next year, the Oriental opened in its stead as a deluxe movie palace and vaudeville venue. The Oriental was closed in 1981, with its lobby spending some time as an electronics store before reopening as a live theater venue called the Oriental Ford Center for the Arts through the 1990s. In 2018, the theater was renamed as the James M. Nederlander Theater and now acts as one of several theaters operating in Chicago's revitalized Loop Theater District, specializing in Broadway performances. Sadly, the property and alleyway are thought to be haunted by a number of the souls who perished in the Iroquois fire, and many entering the area have reported sighting a range of full-bodied apparitions in old-fashioned clothing, some badly burned or blue in the face from suffocation, some just children. Reported throughout Death Alley are faint disembodied cries, extreme cold spots, otherworldly breezes that kick up out of nowhere, and instances in which visitors describe hearing ghostly voices call their names from just out of sight. Lastly, at least one presence on the property is said to be malevolent in nature, with terrifying accounts telling of lone walkers being stalked by disembodied footsteps, the feeling of being closely watched, even unwelcomed, and instances in which the living are touched, tapped, or even pushed by someone or something unseen. Number 2, the Jane Addams Hull House Museum. The Jane Addams Hull House Museum off South Halsted Street in Chicago, Illinois, is a museum located within two of the original Hull House buildings that were originally part of one of the first settlement homes in the country and that now stand as a National Historic Landmark. The house was originally constructed in 1856 by one Charles Gerald Hull and was later leased to Jane Addams in 1889. Jane, accompanied by Ellen Gates Starr, founded a social settlement from the home, titling it Hull House. Hull House first opened a kindergarten, but soon expanded to include a day nursery and infancy care center. Focus of the program was aimed at assisting immigrants in need in the Halsted Street area. By 1907, Addams had acquired 13 buildings surrounding Hull's mansion, and in 1912, a summer camp through the Bowdoin Country Club was added to the complex. Eventually, the project would take on secondary and college-level courses, as well as classes on important issues pertaining to civil rights. When completed, the complex boasted a gymnasium, social clubs, shops, housing for children and single women, playgrounds, parks, and much more. Jane resided in her Hull House until the time of her death in 1935. In 1963, the trustees of Hull House sold the property to the University of Illinois, ensuring its preservation. All additional buildings, aside from the original mansion and adjoining dining hall, have since been demolished. Today, the two remaining structures stand as a museum and memorial to Jane Addams, the first American woman to receive the Nobel Peace Prize, as well as a testament to the marvel her dreams once built and to all the lives she positively impacted. As legend has it, Jane was actually the first to witness paranormal activity within the home, with her reports claiming she'd experienced disembodied footsteps through her room at night and the sounds of someone shuffling around, always just out of sight. Jane came to the conclusion that it was the spirit of Charles Hull's wife, who died in the bedroom in 1860. Jane, as well as several of her friends, all witnessed a ghostly woman in white within the home. This apparition has been encountered into recent years. Also reported throughout the home are a range of apparitions in old-fashioned clothing, thought to be former residents or staff who loved the complex in life. The spirits of three little girls have been seen and heard playing around the fountain just outside the house, and a stern-looking male apparition has been sighted on the stairs. Lastly, one famous legend surrounding the Jane Addams Hull House Museum tells of the dreaded devil baby. As the story goes, a mother-to-be of the strongest Catholic devotion hung a picture of the Virgin Mary within the home to bless her coming child. It's said that her husband, an atheist, was angered by this picture and ripped it from the wall, exclaiming by whatever God might be out there that he'd rather have the devil in his house than any sort of religion. It's said the couple's child was born with scaly skin, hooves, and horns, and that, terrified of the possible repercussions, the ashamed parents abandoned it at Hull House. Legend furthers to tell that Jane attempted to baptize the baby, but couldn't cleanse it of its inherent evil. Eventually, it's said Jane was forced to lock the creature in the attic until one day he vanished, many speculating escaping into the world. To this day, those passing the house have claimed to sight this thing's deformed face peering ominously from the attic window. Number 1, the Congress Plaza Hotel. The Congress Plaza Hotel, or officially the Congress Plaza Hotel and Convention Center, located off South Michigan Avenue across from Grant Park in Chicago, Illinois, is a historic hotel notable for entertaining a wide range of prominent guests over the years, including the likes of U.S. Presidents Grover Cleveland, Theodore Roosevelt, William Howard Taft, and more. The North Tower was initially constructed in 1893 as an auditorium annex used to house the multitude of visitors drawn in for the World's Columbian Exposition, and was originally an annex to the Louis Sullivan's Auditorium building across the street, which at the time acted as a hotel, theater, and office complex. An underground tunnel dubbed Peacock Alley connected both buildings beneath the street. The hotel was expanded from 1902 to 1907 in the form of the construction of the South Tower. In 1911, the hotel complex took the name Congress Plaza Hotel. Over the years, a string of owners and managers continued to make necessary renovations and modernizations, keeping the building in a more than comfortable state. Through the early 1930s, the former Elizabethan Room on the ground floor was transformed into a nightclub named the Joseph Urban Room, and from 1935 to 1936, it acted as headquarters to a Benny Goodman NBC radio production. Through the start of World War II, government purchased the building for use as a headquarters for U.S. Army officers and as a training school for cadets. In 1945, following military use of the property, a group of interests from Chicago pooled resources to reopen the hotel to the public. In 1950, the Pick Hotel Corporation bought the hotel, overseeing a slew of major renovations lasting to 1952. These renovations saw a new front desk and lobby, new suites and restaurants. The early 1960s ushered in construction of a new ballroom, as well as the addition of escalators, rare for hotels of its time. The Congress Plaza remains open to this day, offering sweeping views of Lake Michigan and world-class accommodations. Over the years, the Congress Plaza has built an intense reputation in the world of paranormal investigation for its extreme supernatural activity. One legend tells a workman was either buried or trapped within the walls, built into the structure itself, and several have reported a ghostly hand reaching through various surfaces, especially within the gold room. Another story tells that a mother, fearing deportation back to Nazi Germany, threw her two sons from the 12th story window of their hotel room before jumping to her own death. All across the 12th floor, reports of a ghostly little boy are common, with staff and guests describing spontaneous feelings of fear, panic, and desperation that quickly dissipate upon ascending or descending to different levels. Across the property, many report objects sighted moving on their own, lights flickering or turning on and off with no explanation, and common electronic malfunctions or abnormal battery death. Room 441 is said to be one of the most haunted on site, with security called to its location more than the rest of the hotel collectively. Guests to the room commonly report the shadowy form of a woman that materializes suddenly, sometimes over their bed while they sleep, waking them with rasped breaths. Disturbingly, a handful of reports detail guests being kicked or assaulted by this dark thing. Some have even speculated the severity of this room's hauntings contributed to the inspiration behind Stephen King's story, 1408. Also reported throughout the hotel are disembodied voices heard from empty rooms, the constant feeling of being watched or followed, the feeling of someone unseen breathing down one's neck, and cases of appliances turning themselves on when the kitchens are locked and closed. Chillingly, notorious serial killer H.H. Holmes was known to frequent the hotel's lobby in order to meet and lure women back to his murder castle. And to date, a suspicious entity matching his description has been sighted in passing, a devious smile on his face. Another story tells that the spirit of one Peg Leg Johnny, a homeless man with a wooden leg who was brutally murdered in the connected alleyway, has been sighted roaming the first floor, and the hotel's elevator has a habit of taking unsuspecting guests to the 8th floor, where many report encountering the apparition of an unknown man. A series of legends tell that several rooms throughout the hotel are locked up due to extreme otherworldly activity, and the spirits of a group of children have been sighted running and playing, seemingly always moving just out of sight. Lastly, and possibly most notably, infamous gangster Al Capone is said to have lived in the hotel for a time, with some claiming he may have even owned it under an alias. A number of reports have surfaced detailing encounters with a ghostly figure matching the description of Big Al himself, mostly in the bar and lobby areas, and sometimes accompanied by a range of men thought to be the souls of both associated mobsters and victims. With its ridiculously fascinating history, truly terrifying range of hauntings, and list of ghost stories long enough to keep us all from ever sleeping again, we felt there truly was no better choice than the Congress Plaza Hotel as our pick for the most haunted place in Chicago. Thank you all for tuning in to our list of picks for the most haunted places in Chicago. If you enjoyed hearing our histories and stories as much as we enjoyed telling them to you, don't forget to subscribe to our channel and turn notifications on so you know when fresh content is coming out. Throw us a like if you feel we've earned it, and most importantly, share this video and our channel with anyone you think could use a good scare. We'll catch you all next time.